Welcome this morning, all of you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Well, what a week we've had, haven't we? Scorching hot weather, thunder, rain, and who knows what today will bring. But we are here, come rain, come shine, to worship our Lord. So let's give him our thanks in song as we sing. Joy to the world. Let's stand and sing. Yes, Lord, we come this morning because you are our joy. We come this morning to praise you, to worship you, to thank you. For you are Lord of all creation. And we can sing that song, Lord, because it doesn't have to be Christmas, because Christmas is every day. Because every day you are born in us and you raise us up. And Father, we pray that you will be raised up in honor and glory this morning, in all we sing, all we say, all we do. Father, be present here in the power of your Spirit. Jesus, bring us your joy this morning, that we may have the breath to praise you. And Lord, we may rejoice for all you have done and are doing here and throughout this, your world. We give you grateful thanks. Amen. Right. So this morning, we've got Jonathan bringing us the Lord's message. Bob's going to bring the reading. As you can see, we're going to have communion. And also, finally, we're going to welcome in two people into membership. It's been delayed because of problems with health, but praise the Lord for his intervention. And Shirley and Jim are here, and we give you thanks, Lord, for that. And it's also a certain day, yes? It's Father's Day, yes. So we will remember Father's Day as well. Okay, so we're going to come before the Lord again, reminding ourselves that we are here because of what Christ has done for us. So we're going to sing, so you'll need to be in good voice again. Therefore the redeemed of the Lord shall return, after which Bob will bring us the Bible reading and Jonathan will bring us the message. Okay. So let's stand and sing. Therefore the redeemed of the Lord shall return, which might give you some clue about Ezekiel.
Therefore, the redeemed of the Lord shall return. The reading this morning is from Ezekiel, as you probably guessed. Has been for the last 3 or 4 weeks, but it's a great story. It's the return, the Lord returns to the temple, chapter 43:1-7. The man took me to the gate that faces east, and there I saw coming from the east a dazzling light of the presence of the God of Israel. God's voice sounded like the roar of the sea, and the earth shone with dazzling light. The vision was like the one I had seen when God came to destroy Jerusalem, and the one I saw by the river Chebar. Then I threw myself face downwards on the ground. The dazzling light passed through the east gate and went into the temple. The Lord's Spirit lifted me up and took me into the inner courtyard, where I saw that the temple was filled with the glory of the Lord. The man stood beside me there, and I heard the Lord speak to me out of the temple. Mortal man, here is my throne. I will live here among the people of Israel and rule over them forever. Neither the people of Israel nor their kings will ever again disgrace my holy name by worshipping other gods or by burying the corpses of their kings in this place. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, as you know, this is the... Oh, good morning, everyone. Good morning. This is the... Probably not, if you're speaking generally. Yes, can you hear me all right? Right. This is the fourth of our series, from our series five, about Ezekiel, all taken from the second part of Ezekiel after about chapter 33, when there's a great change in the mood of the book, as I think I explained when I gave an introduction. And that's what we did first time, if you remember. I gave a sort of historical introduction, particularly talking about the fact that the people were in exile and so on. And then after that, Margaret helped us with knowing God in a new way and God giving us his spirit. And then last week we had a dynamic presentation of the dry bones coming to life. And then next week Sue's going to deal with the river of life, one of the lovely passages in Ezekiel, the river of life. And today we have about the Lord returns to his temple, and I wonder what Ezekiel himself might say to us if he were here. He'd probably say, I'm glad you've having a sermon series named after me, but have you actually read my book? Have we? Good question. In particular, Ezekiel might say to us this morning, have you noticed that the last chapters, about chapter 40 onwards, are almost exclusively about one subject? Anybody know? Yes, Betty, I think you got that. No, somebody said it. No, no. No. The temple. He spends all chapters and chapters describing the temple in huge detail. And so that's what we're going to think about this morning, the temple. Why do you think Ezekiel was so worried about the temple? Why was it so important to him? And what are the lessons for us today? It seems a rather arcane subject to be dealing with in 2022. And I have a three-point answer to that, and here goes. Ezekiel is talking about what I'm going to call the structure of worship. I wonder whether you'd like to remember that phrase, the structure of worship. By structure, I mean a building, or if you want to be not too literal, a plan. What am I going to call it? Go on, Marion. A structure of worship.
Good.
When you think about it, we all have them. Well, at least I hope we do. They form an important part of our spiritual life. They can be personal or they can be corporate. So what are you talking about, Jonathan? So I suspect that they usually contain things like prayer, times of quiet, reading the Bible, perhaps reading occasional devotional literature, talking with other Christians about our Christian experience, say answers to prayer or something of that sort. And of course, this is the corporate side of it, church attendance. You all know about that because you're all here this morning. And perhaps most important of all, communion. These are things that we have structured into our lives because they're important to us. And they're not incidental. They're not unimportant. I mean, in our spiritual journey. They are means of spiritual growth. Indeed, of what the Bible calls holiness. Now, that's not a word we use very much nowadays. But holy events are practices and events which we have set aside for God. The whole idea of holiness in the Bible is just that. Something set aside for God, for his use, for his purpose. We know that God is everywhere. And it's slightly anomalous when we pray, for example, Lord, be with us here, at the beginning of our service. Well, actually, we know that God's everywhere. And in a sense, God is in everything. But he's also accessed. We reach him. We touch him. We meet him through special times, seasons, and places. When we call upon him, or meet for worship, or just go out of our way to encounter him, like if we go off on a retreat or something of that sort. Now, I think both of these ideas have dangers, and I just need to mention them. If we think of God as everywhere, we can treat his presence as, you know, something which is diffuse. Is that the word I want? Like a gas, or like the air that we breathe. You know, God is everywhere. And we have no sort of personal relationship with that. That's a danger. On the other hand, if we think of God as only in our structure, only in our prayers, only when we come to church, that's a danger as well. We limit him to particular places and experiences, and that's a mistake, limiting God always. And we exploit him, perhaps, for our own purposes. You know, we say, we've got God in a box. He's got to do what we say, rather than us listening to him and doing what he says. And this leads me to my second point. The whole point of these structures of worship, which we have, prayer and all the other things I mentioned, the point of them is that they become filled with God so that we can meet him and hear his voice. Otherwise, the structure is, so to speak, hollow. It's just a structure. There's a building, but nobody in it. However painstaking our building, however good our routines, however good a scheme of Bible reading or prayer or however faithful we are in coming to church, or whatever it happens to be, whether public or private, it is not serving its purpose if we don't meet God as a result. Because that's what it's for. That's what the structure's about. It's to invite God in. The logicians would say that a structure is necessary, something we need in our spiritual life, but it's not sufficient. It won't take us the full distance. It won't take us where we really need to go. And this is the great lesson of the passage which we read, a wonderful passage about God coming to his temple. It's the high point as far as Ezekiel is concerned, because all this description of the temple is worthless if God doesn't come and fill it himself. As I say, Ezekiel spends a great deal of time describing the temple, but the great moment is when the glory of the Lord fills it, when the Lord comes to live. Let me read those words again. The voice which comes out of the temple says, "Mortal man, here is my throne." You've arrived. You're in the right place. This is my throne. I will live here among the people of Israel and rule them forever. And that is what makes temple building wonderfully worthwhile. That is why our structure of worship is important. Well, you might say, "That's good, Jonathan. You've now said everything that needs to be said, and please sit down." But actually, I have something else to say. Because the chapter goes on, we didn't read it. Even meeting God, at least in this life, I'm not talking about the next life, in this, even meeting God is not an end in itself. Notice that, first of all, although encountering God flattened Ezekiel, or at least he threw himself on the ground, "I threw myself face downwards on the ground," he says. People who meet God are always doing that, and no wonder, you know. But God's response is always, not always, but often, get up, speak to me, get into the action. And that's what happened here. The Lord lifted me, he says, and he took me into the inner court. And then Ezekiel heard the message, and he was to pass on that message to the people of Israel. And it's the same with us, friends. Meeting God is not an ending, but a beginning. It is meant to empower us into service, whatever that service happens to be. And because of this, our chapter has two warnings. Firstly, Ezekiel's temple, as you may remember, was not the first temple. There had been a temple before. We call it Solomon's temple. And the first one had been abandoned by the Lord. There's a little reminder of it in the reading that we had about the temple which had been destroyed. And God had left it, and the Babylonians had destroyed it. Why had God allowed this to happen? Well, if we'd read on, we would have come to a quite clear reason for this. The temple, this is the first temple, had been defiled. Now, we don't need to go into details about that. There was something to do with building the wrong monuments and something to do with, well, the practices which went on, possibly even ritual prostitution. But one way or another, the temple had been defiled. And the verdict is quite straightforward. They disgraced my holy name by all the disgusting things that they did, and so in my anger, I destroyed them. That's verse 8. And Ezekiel goes on to say that the law of the new temple is the same as the law of the old temple, and that is, it's the law of holiness. This is the law of the temple. I'm reading now from verse 12. All the area surrounding it on top of the mountain is sacred and holy. And this is what we've got to think about this morning for ourselves. No structure of worship works that forgets the law of holiness. It's one of the great lessons of the Old Testament as a whole, that religion without righteousness is worthless. Just doesn't work. It's of no interest to God. He says it several times in different places. Religion without righteousness is worthless. The psalmist says, "Who has the right to go up to the Lord's hill? Who may enter his holy temple?" Answer. Does anybody remember? Can anybody quote? Well done, Betty. "He who has clean hands and a pure heart." Our translation says, those who are pure in act and thought. But I like clean hands and a pure heart. I think that's a great translation. Yeah. It is no small matter entering the temple. It's like climbing a steep hill, the hill of holiness. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, it says. Sue and I were on holiday recently, and we were in a little place called Almondbury? Abbotsbury, yeah, where there's a swanery, you know, Abbotsbury, yeah. And the village is down in a bit of a dip, but the hills rise up, particularly the cliffs which overlook the sea very steeply from the village. And right at the top, there is a chapel. And believe it or not, we walked up to it, which was very good for a couple of oldies, I have to say. Yeah. But as we were going up, I remarked to Sue, "Why put a chapel on the top of a hill, for goodness sake? It's such hard work to get there." But funnily enough, when you looked at the way, the places where things were built, particularly the temple in the Old Testament, that's exactly what they did. Ezekiel's temple, and to some extent the first temple as well, were built on a high hill. You went up to the temple. It was an effort. You were expected to, you know, put in an effort to get there. And the New Testament has the same idea. You know, when Jesus announced the kingdom, he didn't just say, "The kingdom of God is among you, the kingdom of God is near." What did he say? "Repent. The kingdom of God is near you." Get yourselves ready for this. There's something to be done. What Jesus is saying is, you can't come under the rule of God, the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. You can't come under the rule of God without repentance. And in his own teaching, Jesus said, "Who will see God? It's the pure in heart. The pure in heart will see God." And in the book of Hebrews, we read, "Without holiness, no one shall see the Lord." And our chapter has the same emphasis. The people Ezekiel spoke to were presented with this wonderful plan, his structure of worship, the temple. But they could only really understand it and enter into it if they were ashamed of their past. And that's the word which is used. I quote again, "Mortal man, tell the people of Israel about the temple and let them study its plan. Make them ashamed of their sinful actions. Then, if they are ashamed of what they have done, explain the plan of the temple to them." Say it again, you can't understand, you can't enter into true worship of God without clean hands and a pure heart. Now, this may seem rather dismal, too challenging, it's not for me, and all that. So I want to just end by leaving Ezekiel 43, and refer instead to a New Testament verse, though this idea is also in the Old Testament. Part of our structure of worship regularly is God's forgiveness. I don't know about you, but I start my prayers every day in the morning by asking God to forgive me. I look back at the previous day, because I have my quiet time in the morning, and think, Lord, I've messed up again. I almost always feel that. You know, we've got to start there. So we have this promise, this wonderful promise. It says, and you all know this verse, if we confess our sins, sorry, let's start at the beginning. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And there's no truth in this. But if we confess our sins to God, he will keep his promise and do what is right. He will forgive us our sins and purify us from all wrongdoing. John 1, 1 John 1, 8 and 9. So I'll finish as usual with some questions, but these are very personal and private questions. I'm not expecting a public answer to them, okay? Do you have an adequate structure of worship? Because if you don't, as a Christian, you need one, frankly. And do you meet God regularly there? Or has it become just a structure? And thirdly, is it being kept clean and in good repair, your structure, by means of repentance and confession? I leave those thoughts with you.
Let's just take a moment to be quiet and think about that. Lord, we thank you that you meet with us where we are. Every moment of every day, you walk with us. And in those special moments, when we make time to come into your presence with your word, you speak in a different way. But you always speak for our good, for our encouragement. So, Lord, we confess before you that we often fail you. We fail to hear your voice as we walk, as we talk with each other. And often our reading of your word becomes routine. Forgive us, Father. And as you have promised, Lord, you will forgive. You are already there with forgiveness even before we ask, because you want to lead us on and take us deeper into you. And Lord, that is what we want, to live lives of worship to you 24/7. Father, accept our words this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing now, All My Days, Beautiful Saviour.
Yeah. will sing this song of gladness. Give my praise to the fountain of delight. For in my helplessness you heard my cry, and waves of mercy pour down on my life. I will trust in the cross of my Redeemer. I will sing of the blood that never fails, of sins forgiven, of conscience cleansed, of death defeated and life without end. Beautiful Savior, wonderful Counselor, clothed in majesty, Lord of history, you're the way, the truth, the life, star of the morning, glorious in holiness, you're the risen one, heaven's champion.
Worship Him all my days.
All my days I will sing this song of gladness. Give my praise to the fountain of delights. For in my helplessness you heard my cry, and waves of trust in the cross of my Redeemer. I will sing of the blood that never fails, of sins forgiven, of conscience cleansed, of death
Shirley and Jim. Yes. Okay, well, finally, we're going to welcome you into membership. We got delayed because they were waiting for Betty, because Betty had her accident, and then Jim was ill, but Betty was received in, so we ended up. So we've been going to do this since the beginning of the year, but we're here, and we praise God. And, well, Jim and Shirley are not strangers to any of you, are they?
No.
No. They're very much a part of our fellowship. So this morning, it's my privilege to welcome them officially as members. They're going to sign on the dotted line. Okay, and we're going to welcome them. So, they've been disciples of Jesus Christ for a long time, and if you want to know, ask them, because they have their stories to tell, and I think that's lovely. So I'm going to ask them a couple of questions. Jim and Shirley, do you believe that God has led you to share his word? Oh, yes. Do you believe that God has led you to share in the worship, life, and witness of this local congregation. Will you continue to share with us the gifts God has given you, that together we may serve God in our local community and in the wider world? Will you share with us in this common life and service, and will you walk together with us before God in ways that are known and yet to be known? Okay, thank you. So, members of the church, if you would like to stand, if you can't stand, just raise your hand, all right? So if the members of this church would like to stand as we also commit ourselves to you. Will you, as members of Matson Baptist Church, promise to share your lives and journey of faith with Jim and Shirley, walking together in ways that are known and yet to be made known? We will. Will you continue to pray for Jim and Shirley and do all you can to help them to witness to Jesus Christ? We will. In our life together, we celebrate the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. So I'd like to welcome you with the right hand of fellowship. Welcome, Jim. Welcome, Shirley. And pray for you both. Okay, Heavenly Father, I'm going to stand behind you. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for Jim and Shirley. Thank you for their love of you and for all the way that you have led them in their lives. Lord, they have held on to you in the ups and downs. And thank you, Lord, for your healing hand upon Jim in these recent days. We give you thanks for that. And we pray for your continuing hand upon them both, that you will continue to lead them in victory in their lives, Lord. That you will bless them each day. And Father, that you will enable them to continue to be a blessing here in our fellowship. Father, surround them with your love and with ours, I pray. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Thank you. Okay. Shall we welcome them? Okay, thank you. Oh, can you sign the book, please? It's easier if we do it now. There you go. So as we come now to communion, let's pray first for ourselves and our world. For Lord, as we come to this table, we come to remember and give thanks. We come as sinners, saved by grace, by your shed blood, Lord Jesus, bringing us forgiveness and new life, which is now and for all eternity. We come with grateful hearts, and with those hearts we wish to intercede on behalf of those in our fellowship, Father, who are struggling with the ravages of age and ill health, with recuperation from operations, and with treatment ongoing. Those with mental struggles, family struggles, with uncertainty of the future. Father, we pray for your overruling by your Holy Spirit, that if in any way we can be an answer to those prayers, we will be sensitive to the move of your Spirit, Lord. And Father, we pray for Matson, for the people living here, for the schools, for the businesses, for the many organizations, and for our fellow brothers and sisters at St. Catherine's, St. Augustine, and Cher Matson. Father, you know the needs of each one. Father, you know all they strive to do. Father, move upon this area in the power of your Spirit. bringing peace, bringing reconciliation, bringing healing and restoring. Father, that the children may grow in secure homes, loved, cared for. That the parents may know, Lord, your presence and your peace and your wisdom, especially before the problems that there are. Lord, we think of the rail workers going on strike and the prospects of perhaps a general strike, Lord. As we were reminded of 76, Lord. Father God, we remember, Lord, for we were around at the last one. Father, when things got difficult, Lord, grant wisdom to our leaders. Guide them, Father, that they will respond correctly. And Lord, leave party politics to one side. Father, for those who come to our country fleeing, we pray for your mercy, Lord. We pray that we will welcome with open arms, as much as we are willing to welcome those from the Ukraine, Father. Father, help us to realize that we are one global family created in your image, created for your glory, Lord, and that we all are equal before you. Father God, have mercy. Father, we pray for the Ukraine, we pray for Afghanistan, and so many other countries where there is fighting, where there is unrest, where there is hatred, where there is persecution. Lord, we would see peace. And you are the Prince of Peace, Lord Jesus. So we pray, Lord, for our persecuted brothers and sisters. And pray, Lord, that you will strengthen them and give them your peace and joy in their hearts. For, Lord, no one can take that away. Strengthen them, we pray, Lord. And grant them great wisdom as they seek to worship you, to share you, Lord. And we pray that for our brothers and sisters who are working throughout this world, taking your message of glorious salvation in difficult circumstances, Lord. We pray for your protection over them. And we pray, Lord, that you will anoint their whole being, that they would just shine for you. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for you go ahead of them. And Lord, you are preparing the way. As you are for us here, open our eyes to see what you are doing and where you are moving. Father, we ask your blessing upon the Testa family, upon the Quinteros family, and upon Victor and Caroline. Lord, may we be faithful in praying for them especially. Lord, we pray this morning that in Lima, in Africa, in Scotland, Lord, you will just pour out your Spirit upon them. And may they see you moving in great power. Watch over the children, Lord. And Lord, may they too have that vision of you. Lord, we return once again to hear, and we ask for your vision for our church, for your person that you are calling to come here next. Prepare their hearts, but most of all, prepare ours as well, so that we together can raise up your kingdom here in this place. Let's say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Apostle Paul tells us of the institution of the Lord's Supper. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's take a moment for private reflection as we prepare. Loving God, we praise and thank you for your love shown to us in Jesus Christ. We thank you for his life and ministry, announcing the good news of your kingdom and demonstrating its power in the lifting of the downtrodden and the healing of the sick and the loving of the loveless. We thank you for his sacrificial death upon the cross, for the redemption of the world, and for your raising him to life again. It's a foretaste of the glory we shall share. We give you thanks for this bread and wine, symbols of our world and signs of your transforming love. Send your Holy Spirit, we pray, that we this morning may be renewed into the likeness of Jesus Christ and formed into his body. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. 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 Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in memory of me." So take this bread and remember that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me." Please retain the cups. We will all drink together. Okay, thank you. Sorry.
sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you'd reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams, in my darkest hours. You are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me?
Right, please be seated. Okay. So, Lord, reign in us. And I think we need to pray for the men of our world, don't we? That the Lord will reign in them and help them because they don't half suffer. They take a lot of knocks these days. And it's a day to remember, isn't it? Some of us remembering fathers that are no longer with us. Some remembering fathers who are present, but perhaps at a distance. To remember all that they meant to us. Their loving, their caring, their instructions, their wisdom. And perhaps for some, it's that thought of a father who was perhaps not so good. Or maybe an absent father, and it's a moment of sadness. But every one of us is created in the image of God, including men. And therefore, they are worthy of respect. Because a father is more than DNA. I can think of many men throughout my life who have helped me, guided me. especially when I've been in places where there wasn't my father. He was literally thousands of miles away, and at one stage, totally uncontactable. But there were others who didn't take on that role, but did in a different way. And all men can choose to help, to guide, to get alongside somebody. And maybe some of you here have not only been fathers to your children, but in a sense, you have been fathers to other people in the way that you have supported them, in the way that you have helped them and guided them. And that is what God does to us, isn't it? He loves us and he comes alongside us and he guides us and he encourages us. And just as God has compassion on us, so he asks us to have compassion on each other. So perhaps you can think of all the ways that you have fathered, even as a young person, somebody else, by encouraging them, by guiding them, by being there for them. So this morning we want to celebrate the men in our church. There's a small token being put together for you, just to remind you that we love you and God loves you. Whether you are a physical father, a DNA father, or a spiritual or a friendly father, you are valued and you are important. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for all the men present here this morning. Each one made in your image, valued and important to you and us, created to worship you, to serve you. And part of that role is to care. And as your word says, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. So we ask that each one would have compassion on those around and each other, and receive from you all they need to live fulfilled, fruitful lives, helping and dealing with the frustrations that life has because it is corrupted. But in you, we, they have hope. Fill each one with hope. Forgive their errors. Renew their vision of family, friends, and all who they encounter and relate to bring your message of life, renewal, and eternal hope. Father, we give you thanks for those who are no longer with us and pray that the good they left we would emulate and continue to develop as we forgive those who let us down in some way and pray that they would find their way back through you, Lord Jesus. Bless the men of this world, especially as still they are often the ones in leadership in an unequal society, putting so much pressure on them that was never meant to be. Lord, have mercy. Lord, once again, we thank you for the amazing men of our church family and ask you to bless them richly, and may they know how appreciated they are. Amen. Amen. Melissa, would you like to take this round? Can you do that for me? Okay. There you go. All you have to do is let the men take one out. Okay? But you can discover them all, can't you? Thank you. Well, we're nearly there now. I've just got a few more notices. Wednesday is the deacons' meeting.
What's that?
That's a leadership meeting for the leaders of the church. Okay? Switch that off, otherwise you get feedback. And then Thursday, who enjoyed the singing practice that came? Was it any good? Right. It comes well recommended. So if you can make it this Thursday, you're very welcome to join us, okay, at 7 o'clock. And something that's not in the notices that you've either received in paper form or by email is Friday, this Friday afternoon at 2:30, down at the shops, the Robinswood School children are singing for the Queen's Jubilee. They'll be in front of the shop singing. Oh, they're probably actually going to be on the green. Okay, so if you want to come down and support them at 2:30 on Friday, I'm sure it will be an amazing sound. Okay, so Friday at 2:30. And then to remind, we have a church meeting on Saturday, the 2nd of July at 10:30. So put that in your diary as well. And you'll be given some homework towards the end of next weekend for it. Okay, and all the other events are as normal. And please be in prayer, especially for Linda as she goes for treatment tomorrow. Praise the Lord that her chest is a bit better. We pray that everything will go well next week for her. And pray for others as well. And welcome back, Yvonne. One of the many. She was you went as well, yes? Yes. Yeah. Back from the Philippines. It was a good time?
Yeah.
Okay. Poor Joe had to stay behind and hold the fort. Next time, Joe. Okay. And welcome to Raoul and Petra and little Sarah. She's a bit bigger than the last time we dedicated her in the Rose Garden. Okay. All right. Lord, we give you thanks for this morning. We give you thanks for everyone here. And we give you thanks that you are our Lord and Savior. Father, we commend ourselves into your hands for this coming week, that you would lead us and guide us, that we would walk with you, we would know your presence, your guidance, and that we would grow in experience and knowledge of you. Father, bless us this week, bless all the activities, be present, be glorified. To you, Lord, we give all the glory and all the honor. Amen. We're going to sing, May the Lord Bless You, and may we sing it to each other. And there is coffee afterwards in the hall.
Thank you.
Turn to the person next to you and say, "The Lord bless you and keep you."